Good afternoon, everyone. Thank God it wasn't a nice, warm, sunny day to be out on the water, so you had to be somewhere, right? I'm Tom Watson, president of the Whitefish Area Property Owners Association. As some of you probably know, if not the others, I'll share that with you. We started doing these summer programs, I guess this is the third year maybe, as a way of just sharing information, providing some help to people, providing a little education maybe on certain of these matters. We live in a wonderful part of north central Minnesota where water is extremely important to us all. And most of our programs have been on water quality, so we have looked at everything from the impact of non-native plants and animals. Actually, I think the first year, Dave can help me, but I think the first year we got talking about water quality, that summer was the first year we detected any zebra mussels, 3 years ago. Yeah, 3 years ago.
The summer before.
Yeah, in August, though, it was about the same time at that time. We've also taken a look at issues around just water quality, what we do with the TSI testing. Where's my buddy Fred? There he is. Our guru on water testing is in the back in the red shirt. We test on 39, 40 lakes, extending from up in the outing area to areas, I guess, as far south as what, Mission and lakes in between. And we do that basically 5 months of the year. Send the results off to a lab. And here's an example of that. Blue is the better color. Red is the color you want to avoid. And this happens to be a five-year average. So there's roughly about, what, Fred, 25 samples or thereabouts that goes into that, five years, something of that sort. We publish this in our newsletter. It's available on our website. It's also interesting to look at this same data set from 4 or 5 years ago and see where it is today. Water quality, in terms of these tests, isn't getting better, unfortunately. Today, we're going to talk about drinking water. And that comes about, frankly, from a couple of experiences. Number one, I ran into this nice young lady up at Alexandria in April, and it was late in the day, and the others were at the reception, I think. And Sarah was wrapping up her afternoon, and so I got talking to Sarah about drinking water, and realized that we really need to be a little more aware about exactly what is drinking water in this immediate area. Second of all, I came from an experience serving in local government for 18 years. Went through 7 elections. No, I'm not running for president. I tried to run when I was wanted to be. Somebody wanted me there. but we ran into an experience with a commercial dump site in the early 90s in which they had buried 55-gallon drums of old paint. And it was first detected when somebody tried to buy a home and they had to have a water test as part of a mortgage contract with the mortgage banker. And of course the well test didn't pass, and consequently this nice home didn't sell. And the lady who brought it to our attention was a young pediatrician who was about 6 months pregnant, and she's explaining in tears about why they can't sell their house and also what's the impact on vinyl chloride on herself and her fetus and all of these kinds of matters. And I can tell you it had a lasting impression on me, and that was in 1991, and I haven't forgotten what she looks like, and I haven't forgotten the conversation ever since. Number three is, in this particular area, what we know is the source of drinking water is relatively shallow. One thing Sarah said to me at the time back in April, something to this effect: whatever you see on the surface water, you might be consuming in a matter of days, because the aquifers are relatively shallow, and what you're getting for drinking water in your immediate area is relatively shallow. Where I came from in the Twin Cities, drinking water was probably 200 feet in rock formations, as opposed to much shallower in this particular area. So the subject today is really on drinking water, and Sarah is part of the owners of AW Research in Brainerd, and they do this for a living. And basically that's her background in working with that. I believe you got a science background.
Biology.
And so the work they've been doing also has been working over in the Pelican Lake area. And just by way of orientation, the Pelican Lake area extending to parts of, essentially, if you think about 371 to the west, roughly, and Highway 6 to the east, and kind of the county line to the north and Pelican to the south is all part of what we call the Pine River watershed, which is a half a billion acres of land and water. And we're all part of that. The significance of that simply means the water in that watershed stays within that watershed, doesn't go somewhere else. And it either flows about that watershed or it percolates into the ground. And it's us. And so that's what we have. And so what we do to the surface ultimately is going to be a part of that groundwater. An awful lot of people in this area, maybe you guys can tell that, you know, what the proportion of on-site drinking water wells are compared to municipal systems in this watershed, but I suspect it's overwhelmingly the majority have on-site drinking water wells in this particular area. The second group I've got is Kevin, is it Strom?
Strom.
And our old buddy Scott Lucas from the Pollution Control Agency. And these guys are biologists who spend their time working in the watershed and looking at and examining and helping us figure out how to manage those. And so they are going to be talking to us a little bit about some of the same business of groundwater, the significance of that, how it impacts and relates to, again, the drinking water we see, some of the hydrology we've got in this particular area. And then what I'll do is after Sarah does her presentation, if you have some direct questions for her, we'll take those. When these two guys are done, we'll do their questions and then we'll open it up for other questions that you may have.
I just have one question.
Yep.
On the comment you just made, you talked about the watershed, the water stays in the watershed. What about what flows out through the dam and cross lake?
That would be, yeah. Yeah, I think what I'm saying is really the natural flowage stays within that watershed. And then within this watershed, I think there are, what, Scott, maybe six or seven minor watersheds?
Six minor watersheds, and they all have 4 points of drainage of the watershed.
Yeah. So those would be areas that would feed. Like, for example, I'm on Big Trout, so basically north to the kind of the county line, that whole area in there is called the Pine River Minor Watershed. I mean, the Big Trout Water Minor Watershed, et cetera. So we have that around. Anyhow, I'm beyond what I may know, well beyond what I may know. But I thought it was important that since we're here and we want to understand how this all works, I might just add, we're not going to talk about pipelines today, but last month we did a piece here with a gentleman by the name of Richard Smith, who is the executive director, president of an organization called Friends of Headwaters based out of Park Rapids, and a gentleman who spends the summers here for a couple of weeks over in Upper Whitefish. He's from Michigan and went through the experience with the pipeline burst called the Kalamazoo River Spill. Some of you may have read the headline, which was a cost of $177 million, some of which was fine, some of which was restoration. Some of us paid particular attention to that also because the spill there, actually, obviously, it's tar sands from Calgary and in the Alberta area, but largely permeated the bottom of that whole Kalamazoo River, and it is there to stay. In other words, it's not very liquid. But it has taken them 5 or 6 years to clean that up. And so the question here is, if a lot of these waters flow into these particular areas that impact us, we get our drinking water from some of those sources, what happens if we were to have a spill or those kinds of matters? We're not going to talk about pipelines today. But just realize that this is this whole business of water, I think it was kind of like a mosaic. I mean, there's many components to it in terms of the chemistry of the water and the other natural impacts that are around it. And then there's this two-legged character running around called a human being that does things to that surface. You know, how many of you ever cleaned your paintbrushes out and back, washing them out of the hose, thinking Mother Earth will take care of that old paint as it filters into the ground? We've all done that. Maybe we're getting a little smarter today as a result of some better education. Enough BS on my part. I want to introduce Sarah Fogderud. She's very attractive. She knows what the hell she's talking about. She's got a lot of good information. She's got a lot of hands-on research and work that they've been doing, as I said, over in the Pelican area, particularly with arsenic. And she can tell you a bit about that whole drinking water business. A pitch that she's going to tell you about. They do the test, a lot of individual home tests. We did a few in conjunction with our annual meeting in June. We're encouraging folks who haven't had those tests, if you're interested, she's got some kits for sale. They're discounted through our organizations. and they'll run the test. We want to try to see if we can't build a better baseline of knowledge, kind of what the groundwater chemistry is in this area and what it looks like in some of these wells and so forth and so on. Here's a pledge. My wife's here and she can verify. We bought our place in 2004. We never did have to provide a well test to anything, but we did have to have a septic inspection. I think that now, as I think about it, that's kind of the reverse. I should have had the well tested too. It was built in 81, and I don't know that the well's ever been tested since it was constructed. And I suspect, having talked to a few of you before we started, there's a few of you in the same boat that haven't had a well test in a number of years. I think what she'll explain a little bit is what happened in Pelican. I don't think that project is old. I think it's relatively new. So the question is, when did they first know about arsenic, and when did it first occur, and some of those things. Sarah?
See if I can get this working.
We'll get you up here.
All right. Well, thanks so much for having me, everyone. This is a big part of our mission as a small business in the Brainerd Lakes area, as we're really committed to educating the public and homeowners on the importance of safe drinking water testing. As Tom mentioned, a lot of you, a lot of people in this area don't really think about, you know, testing their well water. In this country, we tend to take it for granted that we turn on a faucet and we have clean, safe water to drink. But that's not always the case. Unless you are testing it, you don't necessarily know that it's safe to drink. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. What did I do? I already messed it up. We'll see if I can get this going. I'm not the best at technology, so bear with me. Oh, okay. I don't know what I'm doing wrong. I'll just use the arrows. I'm comfortable with that.
Is it showing up?
Nope, there it is. I was just hitting the wrong button. Okay, so as Tom mentioned, I'm one of the... Oh, that one. Okay, thank you. I'm one of the owners of AW Research Laboratories. We're located at the Brainerd Regional Airport. These are some pictures of our lab. If you come out to the airport, you'll see we're just a modular home. We're a separate building from the airport that's been converted into a lab. So we're a pretty modest facility, but we do good work. Alan Sibizar was the founder of the company. He established the lab in 1972. Some of you might remember Paul's Shoes in downtown Brainerd. Well, Alan, that was Alan's dad. He started the lab in the back of the shoe store, and he grew the company to the point where he was able to add a remote sensing division. We used to do overflights, and we did some for the Whitefish Chain to look for pollution sources and septic systems and all kinds of interesting things with Alan's remote sensing imagery. We don't do that anymore. We've discontinued those services, unfortunately. Alan was kind of the brains behind that operation and was really the only one who could interpret the data. So we've sold the planes. We're purely a water testing lab. We do in-house testing, so we run all of the samples right there in our lab for drinking water, wastewater, surface water, groundwater, and stormwater. So any kind of water, we can help you figure out what's in it. And then Alan Sibizar passed away tragically in 2014, very suddenly, unexpected. And so the company was still in the hands of his wife, Shelley, for about a year. And at the end of March in 2015, she was ready to sell, and we as employees were ready to take on the responsibility of owning the business. So three of us employees purchased the company in 2015. So we're 1 year and a few months into business ownership, and things are going really well. So we appreciate the support of the community in allowing us to continue. So today I'm going to talk about safe drinking water. I'll tell you a little bit about the lab testing and how that works, because I think that's something a lot of people don't understand. It's not just magic. We actually have a lot of procedures that we go through to do the testing. I'm going to talk about arsenic in Minnesota, because as a lot of you have been hearing and know about, that's kind of a contaminant in our groundwater that people are starting to be more aware of. And then I'll talk about surface groundwater connection. So what's the connection between the surface water that we see and the water underneath our ground. And then we'll go over some takeaway and some action items that maybe you guys can take home. So safe drinking water, where do Minnesotans get their water? This is kind of an interesting question. So 80% of Minnesotans get their water from community water systems. So that's some public water source that's supplying water. This can be a city, it can be a resort, it can be an airport, a hotel. These systems, 25% of them get them from surface water, 55% from groundwater wells. 20% of Minnesotans are on private drinking water wells. So if you add up the 20% from private drinking water and the 55% from community system groundwater, that's 75% of Minnesotans get their water from groundwater wells. So that's a significant number. The community systems are required to meet federal safe drinking water standards, and these are tested regularly. On the flip side, private wells are tested when they're first drilled, that's required by law, and when the home is sold. But in between those times, it's up to you as the well owner to make sure that the water is safe to drink. So what is a community public water supply? These are basically places, as I said, that provide water to the public in primary living spaces, apartments, nursing homes, resorts, churches. There's over 1,000 community public water supplies in Minnesota. And the testing requirements are set by the Minnesota Department of Health, and they vary by the system, so it depends how many people are using the system and all kinds of different factors as to what testing is required. And this testing is, the samples are collected by the local systems themselves. They also have a lot of Department of Health staff on the ground throughout the state that go out and take samples at resorts and churches and things like that to make sure that the water is safe. And that testing is done by certified laboratories that have a contract through Department of Health. So there's a rigorous system that labs have to go through to get this contract. We're one of those labs, so we do get some of those Department of Health samples. So I'm just gonna briefly go over lab certification. This is kind of complicated stuff, but it basically means when you take your water to a certified lab, you're going to a place that is following protocols and following proper procedures to make sure that we're getting quality results. So we at AW Research Laboratories are certified for 28 different analytes under both the Clean Water Program, which covers wastewater and surface water, and the Safe Drinking Water Program, which is, as it says, safe drinking water. So these are federal programs, federal EPA standards for these types of water. We're required to get an independent audit every 2 years, and that is submitted to the state. So we hire an auditor to come in, go over with a fine-tooth comb everything that we do in our lab, and they provide us back with a report against the state and federal regulations to let us know what we're doing wrong, what we're doing right, and then we have to make those corrections or we can risk losing our certification. And then we also are required to do proficiency testing twice a year, so these are basically unknown samples. So we order these from a company that provides standard samples with set concentrations. We have to run them not knowing what those concentrations are supposed to be, and the results need to match up. So to be a certified lab, you really do have to go through quite a bit of regulations and that certification process so you know that we're doing quality work and getting good results. So safe drinking water, we usually recommend testing for three things. The first of them is always total coliform bacteria. This is a family of bacteria that includes E. coli. So it can be harmful to your health, it can make you sick. It's also an indicator of well contamination and other potential pathogens. So when we talk about testing water, it's impossible for us to take a water sample and tell you everything that's in that sample. That would be really nice, but it's just too expensive, too difficult to do. So what we do is we pick out indicators, and that this total coliform bacteria is used as an indicator because it's simple to test for, it's relatively inexpensive, and it tells us if there's an issue with your well. So coliform bacteria is common in the soil on the surface of the ground, but it doesn't live more than a few feet deep in the soil. So it really shouldn't be in your well. It has no business being in there. So if you do have coliform in your well, that indicates that somehow surface water is getting into your well system, or your well has been contaminated through another pathway. If you have E. coli in your well, so every time we test for total coliform, we're also testing for E. coli. If you have E. coli in the well, that indicates a more serious issue, fecal contamination from septic or animal waste, something like that getting into your well. We had a lady just about a month ago who had E. coli in her well, and we couldn't figure out what was going on. She had a well driller come out and do an inspection, and there was an ant nest in her well. So apparently insects can cause E. coli as well. So you just never know until you test what might be going on. Just quickly to give you an idea of how we do the testing for bacteria. So what we do is we take our sample bottle here with your water sample. We use these media, which is basically bacteria food. So it's these little pouches. There's two different kinds. They're both made by a company called IDEX, Call Alert and Call Assure. Call Alert is a little more sensitive, so the Minnesota Department of Health requires that one, so we run those for Department of Health. Call Assure we use for most well samples because it's an easier test and it's a little bit quicker and easier for us to run in the lab. The samples are checked for chlorine before analysis. The way to get rid of bacteria in the well is to chlorinate the well. So when we run a sample, we want to make sure that there's no chlorine so we know that we're getting a good test. So this is what our incubator looks like. So once we put the media in the sample, we incubate it at 35 degrees Celsius, which is basically body temperature, about 98 degrees Fahrenheit, for 24 to 48 hours. And a color change in the media indicates the presence of bacteria. So this is our Call Alert example. This is a sample that is fine. There's no bacteria in the sample, so it's the same color it was when it was brought in. This is an example of a positive sample. So can you see the yellowish tint? So it'll turn yellow if there's coliform bacteria in the sample. This is the other one. We like this better because it's a little more obvious. So when we put the media in your sample, it turns yellow. So this is the Call Assure method. So this is a good sample. This means there's no bacteria. If there is bacteria, it turns this really nice purple color. So it's really easy for us to tell. We like this one because a lot of wells in Minnesota have a lot of iron, and so they'll come into the lab already looking kind of yellow like this. So it's a little more difficult to tell the color change on this method. So that's why we like to use this one. It's a little more obvious. And then the way we test for E. coli is E. coli fluoresces under a black light. So what we would do is we would take these positive samples, put them under a black light, and if they're positive for E. coli, you can see it glowing. So it's a pretty straightforward test. And it's kind of fun to see them glow. Although it's not good for the person who has the well. We kind of get excited when we have a glower. So this is one of our lab techs, Lori. This is her setting up bacteria in the lab. We test the chlorine in these little cups, and then she's lined up her bottles here, writing them in the book, and she'll add the media to put them in the incubator. So the Department of Health recommends testing for total coliform once every year. That's because it's a good indicator of contamination. So if you're going to do any test on your well, this is what they recommend to make sure that it's safe and hasn't been contaminated over the last year. We also recommend this anytime you make changes to your plumbing. You're putting in a new plumbing fixture, changing out a softener or something like that. When you're opening up your system, you're risking contamination. So if you do have a softener and you're adding salt to it, make sure you wash your hands really well before you handle the salt and put it in there. Anytime you're opening that system, there's a chance for contamination. And if you do find it in your well, it's actually a pretty easy fix. You chlorinate the well. And many of you maybe already do this on a regular basis to get rid of that sulfur smell. It's the same procedure. So the next one we recommend testing for is nitrates. And elevated levels in wells can be caused by animal waste, agriculture, residential fertilizer use, sewage or septic leaking. So this is kind of another indicator that there is a contamination source to your well. And it's highly soluble in water, so it's actually a common contaminant in a lot of Minnesota groundwater. We don't see it a ton in the Brainerd Lakes area just because we don't have that agricultural source, but it's actually getting to be more and more. We're actually seeing more and more wells come in with a little bit elevated levels of nitrates in them as that agriculture starts to spread. It's harmful to infants. The reason there's a health standard, and I should say the health standard for nitrates is 10 parts per million. It's harmful to infants under 3 months because when we ingest nitrates, our bodies convert it into something called nitrites, which is another form of nitrates, and that inhibits our blood from being able to take up oxygen. So it causes something called blue baby syndrome, and infants are very susceptible to this. And it actually can suffocate the baby, so it inhibits their ability to take up oxygen. So that's why there's a health standard, is really for infants. We don't know what the long-term effects are of drinking nitrates over a long period of time. So, you know, for everyone, it's best just to not have elevated nitrates. The way we run nitrates in the lab is a little bit different than the bacteria. We use a probe that measures millivolts, and we compare it to a standard concentration curve. It sounds very complicated, but basically we put our probe into a standard known concentration. We create a curve with several of those, and then we compare your sample results to that curve. So for nitrates, the Department of Health recommends testing every 2 to 3 years, or more often if you've had an elevated sample. So this isn't something you need to do every year. We typically will just have people do it because they don't always know when they've done it last. But if you know you did it last year, you probably don't need to do it this year. Shallow wells are more prone to contamination. They're more susceptible to those surface sources, those fertilizers and septic and things like that. So if you have a sand point, I would recommend testing every year just because you are a little bit more prone to that contamination. And if you find elevated levels, they can be filtered out with a reverse osmosis system. Or, you know, if you can figure out what the source of the nitrates is, you can remove the source. But typically people just go ahead and install the reverse osmosis. So just a little visual on septic systems, and something to think about is even functioning septic systems don't remove all contaminants. They're not really designed to take out everything that we put into our water. They're really only designed to neutralize bacteria and to take out any harmful bacteria. So septic tanks, you all know this because you probably all have them. The drain field requires, you know, once it goes through the drain field, it requires a period to absorb into the soil. And the soil then purifies the water and is part of your treatment process. So it's important that your system is rated for the use of your home. So the number of bedrooms in your home will determine the septic. So if you add onto your home, this is why it's required to have a septic inspection to make sure that it can absorb that capacity. So it's very important to just keep that in mind, your system capacity versus your usage of it, so that you don't overrun it. And it's good to remember too that a lot of what goes in your system will eventually end up in the groundwater, and particularly in our area with the type of soil that we have, that sandy soil that drains very quickly, we don't get a lot of this soil absorption purification time. And our water tables are, especially around lakes, are pretty high. So there's less space for that water to have time to percolate and to purify before it gets to the ground. This is a really interesting map that I found from the Department of Health and Department of Agriculture. And they're taking a lot of information, geology, the permeable material in the soil, the land use of the area, the water table depth, and they put it all together on a map that shows the nitrate probability map. So it's the probability of nitrate contamination for different areas. So this is Crow Wing County. The highest probability is in red, the lowest is in green. So you can see, you know, over here where there's not a lot of lakes, a little bit different topography and soil types, there's not a huge probability of contamination. But up here around the Whitefish Chain and the lakes, you see a much higher probability for contamination. And this is, Scott will probably talk a little bit about this too, but this is the based on the soil types and things like that. So we know if we live around lakes and in these areas that we are at a higher risk for contamination for nitrates. All right, and the last thing, the third thing that we recommend testing for is arsenic. And this, as I said, is kind of an emerging concern for people. We're starting to see a little bit more of it purely because we're testing for it more often. Because arsenic's naturally occurring in groundwater in our area. Around here, it was deposited by the glaciers. We're in that glacial till area. So it's been here a long time. We're only now starting to test for it. And the concern with arsenic is for long-term exposure to low levels. So it's a carcinogen. And like any carcinogen, the more you're exposed to it over time, the greater your risk of developing cancer. So it's linked to certain types of cancer of the bladder, lungs, liver, other organs. And the only way to know if you have arsenic is to test for it. And this is the same as with bacteria and nitrates. There's no taste, there's no color, there's no odor to the water with these parameters. So the only way to know is to test for it. So the Department of Health estimates, and I've seen 15%, 10 to 15% of wells in Minnesota are above the federal health limit of 10 parts per billion. And if you have elevated arsenic, you can install a reverse osmosis system, and a lot of times it'll be this separate drinking water tap, that filtration system under your sink. And there's a new rule in Minnesota as of 2008, all newly drilled wells are required to be tested for arsenic. Prior to 2008, they were only required to be tested for the coliform bacteria and nitrates. So if your well was drilled prior to 2008, it's probably never been tested for arsenic. This is just a quick little picture of how we run arsenic in the lab. This is kind of the most mysterious test that we do, to me anyway. It's called atomic absorption spectrophotometer. So it's measuring the absorption of optical radiation or light. So measuring how much light is absorbed by the arsenic atoms in a gaseous state. So it basically vaporizes the sample, shines some light through it, and tells us the concentration. So it's kind of a smoke and mirrors magic testing machine. It's the most expensive piece of equipment that we have because arsenic and other heavy metals are very difficult to test for. So if you see someone who has a quick test for arsenic, it's probably not going to be very accurate because it does require a pretty sophisticated piece of equipment to get an accurate number. I get a lot of questions about the arsenic health limit. So the arsenic health limit used to be 50 parts per billion, and this was established in 1975. And so a lot of people ask me, well, why did they change it? Why is it 10? So if I'm over 10 but under 50, am I still okay? Well, it's kind of up to you. A 1999 study by the National Academy of Sciences determined that the limit of 50 parts per billion did not meet the goals of protecting public health. So when they're setting health limits for these parameters, they're always balancing protecting public health versus the cost of doing it. So EPA did some studying. They proposed a new standard of 5 parts per billion in the year 2000. And eventually they settled on 10, basing that off of the cost and the benefits for protecting public health. So it's a level that maximizes the health risk reduction at a cost that is justified by the benefits. So it's, as I said, it's a very, you know, complex weighing of, you know, costs and benefits. So if you were gonna do a purely health-based standard for arsenic in your drinking water, probably would be 2 to 3 parts per billion is what I've read according, you know, different sources. But the health limit is set for 10 for public water supplies. So as a private home owner, a private well owner, it's a personal decision for you. So it's up to you what level of arsenic you find acceptable. If you have 50 parts per billion in your well, no one's gonna tell you you have to put a treatment system in. If you have 2 parts per billion, you still might wanna treat it. It's just totally your decision. So as a lab, we just try to give you the information and help you to make that decision on your own. So here's a few stats of arsenic in Crow Wing County in particular. This is from the Department of Health. In 2008, as I said, they started requiring arsenic on newly drilled wells. So this data is from 2008 to February of 2015, about 1,900 wells. 28% of those wells had arsenic over 2 parts per billion. About 4% had them greater than 10 parts per billion, so over the health limit, about 4% of wells in Crow Wing County. This only includes new wells. It might be higher if all of the wells were included. Here's a link to where I got it from. It's really interesting, actually, if you go to the Department of Health. They have these maps, which is kind of cool. So you can see the whole state of Minnesota. And this shows the same thing, the percent of wells that had arsenic greater than 2 parts per billion. And the percentage increases as you get darker. So the lighter, you know, we're less than 20% of our wells had arsenic greater than 2 parts per billion. Over here in the western part of the state and down in the metro area, you can see, I think that's 60% or greater wells had arsenic over 2. Here is the map for 10. So this is wells with percentages over the health limit. So again, you see we're kind of actually in this little pocket of the best part of the state. We are less than 5% of our wells have arsenic over the health limit, but we still have some. You see much more of it in agricultural areas. Arsenic used to be a component to certain types of pesticides. So there was a lot of that dumped in the 50s, and that's still residual in the groundwater. Down in the southern part of the state, same thing. And if you compare it to the geology, this Des Moines till, which is glacial deposits, we're kind of in this little pocket where there's not as much. So it follows the geology, which I think is really interesting. So this is a map that our lab has put together of wells that we've tested that people have given us permission to put their results on the map. Anything over the health limit is in red. So you can see we've done quite a lot of testing around Pelican Lake, a few kind of on the east side that are over the health limit. We found a lot of arsenic in the Merrifield area. This is North Long Lake right here. In Aiken County, we have several wells. Most of the people that we tested were over the health limit, but that doesn't mean that every well in these areas will be. That's the thing about wells and arsenic, is it really depends on the geology and the soil that the well is going through as to how much arsenic you'll have. So you might have high arsenic because you have a deeper well and you're going through certain clay layers and things like that. Well, your neighbor with a shallower well might not. So it really goes from well to well. So that's why we recommend everybody test for arsenic at least once, just to know what you have. Because just because your neighbor has it doesn't necessarily mean you will. This is a little bit zoomed in of just like the Brainerd area. So you can see here, Pelican Lake, again, a little closer up. We've done some testing with Gull Lake Association on the southern part of Gull Lake, almost into the Baxter area. We have some higher arsenic. Up here, Cross Lake, we have not done as many wells, which is why we would really encourage you to get in the program and give us your results, because we'd love to see kind of what's going on up here. The limited testing we've done shows that everything's coming back pretty low. We've got one up here. I'm not sure what lake that is. Daggett with a high arsenic. And these maps are in the back too. If you didn't see that, feel free to take a closer look. So I'm going to talk just a little bit now about the surface water connection to groundwater. This is one of my favorite quotes. A lake is a landscape's most beautiful and expressive feature. It is Earth's eye looking into which the beholder measures the depth of his own nature. That's from Henry David Thoreau from Walden. But I just love that image of a lake being an eye, because it really is our eye to the groundwater. As you can see, you know, lakes and groundwater are inextricably connected. They're just linked together. And we don't always think about that, because we can see the lake, but we can't see the groundwater. But it's all connected. We sometimes think of lakes as a bathtub, but lakes aren't that way. They're constantly flowing in and out with groundwater. So this is a study that we did with the Pelican Lake Association, as Tom mentioned. From 2014 to 2015, we tested 13 wells for arsenic and total phosphorus and chlorides and lots of other parameters. 13 wells isn't a lot, so please take this information with a grain of salt. It's just a first look kind of at what's going on. But we did find a strong correlation between arsenic and total phosphorus, a 0.958, which a perfect correlation would be 1. So the higher the arsenic in the well, the higher the phosphorus, which I thought was really interesting. So there does appear to be some kind of relationship between phosphorus and arsenic, at least in this case, these 13 wells. Phosphorus, of course, we know is a contaminant concern for our lakes, as you have displayed over here with your lake water testing. Phosphorus can really contribute to a lot of problems for lakes. Arsenic is a human health concern. So we have these two parameters that are linked. We're linking our human health to our health of our lakes. And this is interesting too. Phosphorus and arsenic are very chemically similar, which is why arsenic is so harmful to humans. The human body is really efficient at utilizing phosphorus. And because arsenic is so similar, when we're exposed to arsenic, our bodies really quickly absorb that arsenic and take it in because they think it's phosphorus. And that's why it's a poison, because our bodies are just so efficient at utilizing it. So they're kind of two molecules that are very interconnected. A little bit more about our study, which is kind of the surface water connection. So if we're looking at the phosphorus in Pelican Lake ranges from 5 to 15 parts per billion during the summer. So it's a pretty clean lake. Phosphorus in the wells that we tested was as high as 830 parts per billion. So that's quite a big jump between the groundwater and the lake water. But we know that Pelican Lake is primarily fed by groundwater. So eventually, there's got to be some connection between that phosphorus in the groundwater and the lake water. And we're already starting to see some water quality issues on Pelican Lake, despite the fact that the phosphorus levels are pretty darn good. It could still be having a negative impact on lake water quality in the form of this tulipy squeeze, which maybe some of you have heard about this before. This is basically where tulipy are kind of an indicator fish. They're a cold water fish, and they don't like the temperature of the water to be too warm, and they need a lot of dissolved oxygen, like most fish do, to live. So they, in the middle of the summer, as the warmer waters at the surface, as the surface waters warm up, the temperature gets to be too high. If it's greater than 20 degrees Celsius, the fish can't be in that water, so they get kind of pushed lower. Well, as we get increasing levels of phosphorus and other nutrients at the bottom of the lake, we start to get anoxic conditions. Dissolved oxygen goes down because it's being utilized, and we get too low dissolved oxygen for the fish at the bottom. So you get this squeeze effect where the fish have a narrow band of water where they can actually survive. And in the most extreme cases, that squeeze gets all the way, you know, flatlined so that there's no place for those tulipy to live. So this is something the DNR is really focusing on, and pollution control too, I believe, to identify lakes that could be good indicators of what's happening with these tulipy, and protecting particularly forested land around the lakes to make sure that we're protecting our water quality. But the groundwater component of this is interesting to me as well. If we have high phosphorus in some groundwater wells, there must be some kind of phosphorus source feeding those lake waters as well. So here's the takeaway. The cost of cleaning up contaminated groundwater is 10 to 30 times more expensive than working to prevent and reduce groundwater contamination. Like any type of pollution, it's much more expensive to clean it up than it is to prevent it. We all know this. So protection is key. Protecting our groundwater is important. And groundwater and surface water are connected in complex ways that we don't understand fully. So it's even more important to do that protection piece. And there's a connection between human health and environmental health. We know this with air quality and things like that, but it's true with our groundwater as well. And protecting the groundwater is important for the environment. It's important for our health. So here's some action items for you. Have your water tested annually by a certified lab. Maintain your septic system, because that can be a huge source of contamination to our groundwater. It should be inspected annually, pumped every 3 to 5 years, depending on the size of the system and your usage. Fertilize less. We live in a beautiful area. You don't need to fertilize your lawn. We have lots of beautiful plants and things that don't need fertilizer up here. Conserve water. And tell your friends. Spread the word that this is important, and talk about what you learned today. And that's all I have. So if anyone has any questions, I'd be happy to help.
Questions for Sarah? Okay.
Yeah.
When you test before or after stopping the water?
We usually, for the like the bacteria and the nitrate tests.
Could you repeat the question?
Oh, yeah.
This, and we don't pick up the sound from the audience. So
sure.
If one of you could repeat the question, then people watching the video would be better off.
Got it. So the question was, when you're testing your water, you test it before or after your softener? What we usually recommend is testing it where you drink it from, for the total coliform and the nitrate test. For the arsenic, a softener can interfere. It can sometimes take out a little bit of arsenic. So we usually recommend taking that test before a softener. So it kind of depends on what you're testing and what you want to know. But typically, it's where you drink it from. Yeah. Yeah.
Sure.
a list of the 28 analytes that you're certified to test for?
Oh, do I have a list of 28 analytes we're certified to test for? I don't have it on me today. You can go to our website, awlab.com, and I believe there's a list there. Otherwise, you can, I have a card in the back. You can contact me and I can send it over.
We should post that on our website.
John? Yeah.
Do you test for trichloroethylene or solvents?
We do trichloroethylene or solvents. Do we test for them? We do not test for those in our lab, but we have relationships with other labs that we can send them out to, so we can certainly help you to figure that out and get you the right containers and connect you with a lab that can do the work for you. Yep. Yeah.
Is there a long-term effects of arsenic, or what the health symptoms are?
Sure. So the long-term health effects of arsenic include it's a carcinogen, so it's a risk of developing certain types of cancer. The longer you're exposed to arsenic, particularly higher levels of arsenic, the greater risk you are of developing cancer. Arsenic's a poison, so if you were to drink a bottle of it, you would die, you know. But it's like any carcinogen, it's just that long-term exposure. And the more we can reduce our exposure to those carcinogens, the better off we'll be.
Let me just add a piece. I'm not sure so much about arsenic, but I do know from my earlier experience, when these health standards are set, they're primarily focused on young infants, newborns, and what they call older, vulnerable adults.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like one. in other words, the presumed healthy folks in the center, the standard is you know, above whatever that would impact them naturally, I think. And that's probably still the case here.
Yeah, so that's true. They usually do set those standards for the most vulnerable people, so for infants, for elderly people. You know, what we usually tell people, because obviously it's up to you if you want to treat your water for arsenic. Some people choose, like if it's just a cabin and they're coming up on the weekends, they're not going to worry about it because they don't drink that water every day of their lives. Or they'll bring bottled water for the weekends or something. But if you live in that home and you're drinking that water every single day, I would definitely recommend a treatment system because you are going to accumulate that arsenic in your system over time and develop those risks.
Is it absorption?
Oh yeah, is there an absorption of arsenic, like if you bathe in the water? No, you can't absorb arsenic through your skin. It's only consuming the water. So drinking, cooking is basically the concern. So you can get a whole house system to take care of arsenic, but that's usually not necessary. Some people do that because they just get freaked out and they don't want any arsenic. but you really only need that separate drinking water tap.
Could be washing your vegetables though.
Yeah, or washing produce, yep.
And Tom mentioned, something about a woman that was concerned about fluoridation. No?
No, the one, you mean the example I was talking about?
Yeah.
No, that was just simply a well test that had failed because of vinyl chloride.
Yeah, anyway, fluoridation is not a problem.
Yeah.
10 parts per million.
Yeah, this wasn't a fluoridation question.
Right.
Yes.
After a summer of heavy rains and high water and all those things, is the likelihood of contamination in the wells higher because of those conditions this year?
So the question is, with the high rains that we've had and the increasing water levels, is there more of a risk for well contamination? The easy answer, or the quick answer, would be yes. In general, as the water tables rise, there's more issues with septic systems getting overrun, things like that, or with the rains washing everything kind of out and mixing everything up, there is higher risk of contamination, particularly if you have like a sandpoint well or, you know, those wells close to the surface. Yeah, definitely you should have them tested if there's been a lot of rain or flooding, for sure. Yeah?
This is a more generic question, and my neighbors on the South Bay at Cross Lake have asked me to ask this question.
Okay.
Every Saturday and Sunday we have anywhere from 50 to 75 pontoon boats sitting out on a sandbar. Many of them are there all day. So there is ample evidence of public urination into that lake. And if surface water becomes well water, do we have anything to worry about this public nuisance in addition to the noise? I'm more concerned about
just be careful. careful, the current mayor is sitting here listening to me.
So the question is, you know, when people gather on the summer day and on sandbars and they're there all day, there must be some public urination going on. Is this a health concern for our drinking water and our wells? Is that correct?
Yes.
So I would say no, because by the time that water gets into your well, it's probably been cleaned up. It is a concern for swimming on the beaches and things like that. You know, if there's E. coli on the beaches, they'll shut the beach down. So obviously it's not a great idea. But you know, the lake is so big and it all gets kind of diluted, so it's probably not a huge public health concern.
The noise issue might need to be a bigger
problem. Yeah, but you're probably worse off with the decibel level.
Or the broken bottles.
Yeah. I did. The solution to pollution is dilution. That was one of Alan's favorite sayings. Yep, yep.
I would just add two things to things Sarah said, because I really appreciate what she had to say. I came from a background on septic inspections and pumping, which is 2 years. Now, here's my point. It costs you probably $170 or $150 every 2 years to have your tank inspected. My guy is only 170, Steve, I don't know. But my point is, it costs that every 2 years, and if you select your right inspector and pumper, they will actually have mirrors, they can look in that tank, they can look at the walls, they can make sure that the holding tank itself is solid and secure. The cost of replacing that system is gonna cost you probably $10,000 or more, okay? So if you break that down to $100 a year as an annuity, it's pretty inexpensive. Second thing I've learned, my wife's here, she can verify this. This is about 2-3 years ago. We noticed some water burbling up on the floor of the basement. And what we discovered was that our drain field had 25 years of roots and little whatever else trees grow and plant materials grow and whatever. So I happened to find a guy, I won't advertise his business, but if you ask me, I'll tell you, who actually has a machine driven with mirrors and cutting devices that'll go right through your entire drain field and clean that thing out. That cost me $300. The conclusion from that, he said to me, you're good for 20 years. In other words, I don't have to replace the drain field because he can do that sort of thing. My point is, where I was mayor, we had an ordinance that required inspections every 2 years. We had a log. You didn't turn it, if your pumper didn't turn in his card on your site, you would get a little postcard. Say it's been 2 years. Okay? And the whole point of that was prevention, mm-hmm. which I totally agree with. And second of all, you don't want to have your drain field and other things observed through effluent and other things that are now coming to the surface because you got a drain field that's not functioning, you got a solid tank that's broken down, whatever. $100 a year is a hell of a lot cheaper than replacing one, because that's the next test. And the health standards on drinking on on-site septics, I worked with a guy by the name of Mackmeyer, who was one of the original authors of a lot of the on-site septic systems from the university. This was his advice on on-site systems, was to do that inspection every 2 years. And the important part of that was also the fact that you actually had the visual inspection.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's really, really significant. Now up here, somebody just asked me earlier, what is Crow Wing County doing or what does the city do on inspections and those kinds of things? I don't think there's any mandatory inspections on septic systems in anywhere in this area. I don't know. Scott, do you know?
I don't know either.
But I don't think there is.
They fund some with grants.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
So in a lot of cases what's going to happen is they're going to report an incident when they start seeing effluent on the surface. And usually it's a neighbor talking about what's happening on the neighbor's property because you smell it. And that's not a good time to do it. So that's
yep.
the only things I would add to that.
Yep.
The piece she commented on Cisco's tulipies,
mm-hmm.
If any of you are interested, 2 years ago in the spring, we had Peter Jacobson, who is a research biologist in fisheries from Park Rapids, who did a piece on big trout, which is one of the deep water lakes that actually is a reservoir for lake trout, walleyes, etc. If you're interested in that study, it is to explain exactly what Sarah pointed out, is that over time, the chemistry of that lake, 140 feet in its deepest place, is starting to narrow that range big time. And right now it's still healthy, but we're starting a project in conjunction with City of Manhattan Beach and Crow Wing Soil and Water Conservation to manage stormwater all along the east side of 66, right there opposite Big Trout. I know that we're having some conversations with the mayor and the public works folks in Cross Lake, because the remaining part of 66, another 4 or 5 miles, dumps into Loon Lake, dumps into Rush, and dumps into Cross, and a lot of those systems aren't being managed. They've been installed by Crow Wing County. They're not cleaning out, but that's changing the chemistry of that water too, so mm-hmm. it's a problem. But if you're interested in the Jacobson piece, because you want to see it from a cold water fish perspective, go out to our website. Where's Alan? I think it's still out there, isn't it? It's out on our website. You can find the Jacobson piece, and it's really pretty dang good. Other questions for Sarah?
Steve? A couple things, Tom. We used to build pipe that was supplied to grain fields. One of the things you really want to do is pump your septic system more often than less. The killer of the grain field is pumping the solids from the septic system into your grain field, and it's all over in you. I don't care how new your system is, when you plug it up, it's over. And so you really should be no longer than 2 years. And the other little clue is pump it in the spring, not in the fall,
right?
Because you want the heat retained in your system to keep it from freezing. And if you pump all that heat away in the fall, you're more likely to freeze it up.
You get on my schedule, it's middle of June is my schedule. Good points. Sarah, we'll stick around. If you've got some other questions that could come up, as I told these two guys, a lot of times when we put two topics together, there's some synergy between them, and questions raised by one or new material by the other raises questions. So we'll have some time for some other ones too.
Yep, I'll be around for a while too, and I'll have the kits in the back at the end if you want to pick one up.
All right, thanks, Sarah.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, incidentally, she's got the kits back there. Sarah, the what, 51?
53.
And they are a three-part test. So coliform nitrates and arsenic, and they'll do just exactly what she said. And then what we're gonna try to do as an association is try to manage, or help them, if you will, build that profile of that and baseline of lakes around the immediate area. And it's only with your permission that we would get that data to be able to produce those maps like she showed, you know, around Pelican and some of those things. We just think that would be useful information for all of us to know, and you in particular, as we do that. All right. Now, I have to tell you a quick story about these two gentlemen. Well, Scott and I have known each other. We haven't worked together really very much, but he's got a terrific reputation in this area. As the guy that probably knows more about this watershed than probably anybody yet alive. I think Ron Meyer isn't here, and our dear friend Jack Walschlager passed away, so, you know, I think between the three of you guys, it's it, right?
Yeah, well, Jack, I think, could have gone with the two of us.
And Kevin Stroom, I haven't met before today. What I really wanted to do initially was to do some discussion about what some of the drinking water standards are, in all of that, and my folks that were supposed to do that bailed on me. So I'll tell you what kind of people these guys are. They're great. I make a call Tuesday morning and to their boss, and I say, here's what I need, and they said, got two people. So I look at the directory and I see three names of people I've known. Bonnie Finnerty was the planning director for Crow Wing County for a long time, and then Scott. And so I said to their boss, Laurel, I said, well, I know a couple, three of these guys know a heck of a lot of stuff. So here they are. And what they're really gonna do is talk a little bit about some of the hydrology, some of the groundwater, I suspect, and what's happening from that side of things. They're not gonna talk about what's going on in the laboratory. They're gonna let Sarah do that.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And Scott's been working with the Pine River Watershed on what they call a RAPS plan, which is basically a water area protection and restoration program, and looking at kind of what's happening in this particular watershed. Now keep in mind, I said that's 500,000 acres of water and land. if you're in this area, and I just quickly looked at the sign-in sheet, there may be one or two of you in Cass County, which may not be part of this watershed, but you're darn close. So, who's going first?
Tag teaming it.
Yeah, we're tag teaming. He's got the orange shirt.
Is this on? Yeah, I think it is.
You're on.
Okay.
Kevin Stroom.
So yeah, we're the backup team today, so we're a little bit out of our league. Both of us deal more with surface water issues. Scott's a project manager, and he works on these RAPS projects, which we at the PCA do some intensive monitoring throughout a given watershed, lakes and streams and rivers. And we, like the Pine River watershed, we did that monitoring, what, 3-4 years ago? And then we make assessments on what we find, and if rivers or lakes are impaired, then we have to come up with kind of a prescription on how to fix those, and then there's grants and things that are available to do that later on. And my part in that typical process is to sort of investigate why I work on streams and rivers rather than lakes. So if we have an impaired stream, I go out and try to figure out why it's impaired, and then people can figure out what to do to fix that. So again, we do more surface water things, but we do have some knowledge of groundwater, and like Sarah said, groundwater and surface water are very interconnected, especially in some places, and the area in this north central Minnesota is one of those areas where they're pretty intimately connected, in part because the groundwater is very shallow here.
Yeah, we you know, in developing the RAPS, you know, the Watershed Restoration Protection Plan strategy for the Pine River, I really wanted to include the groundwater element because knowing a little bit about this watershed, we've got a really pretty shallow groundwater table, and so, you know, when you implement best management practices to address surface water, you want to make sure that what you're doing is also good for the groundwater. So it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to do something like, say, a big, huge infiltration basin that's going to, you know, potentially put contaminants into your groundwater if you've got a shallow groundwater table there. So that's something we wanted to keep an eye on and make sure that whatever we did was going to be both beneficial to groundwater and to surface.
So let me see if I can make this work right. Okay, why is groundwater important? As Sarah mentioned, with some good statistics, we only had about a day to put this together, so ours isn't quite as fancy, but it is the source of drinking water for an awful lot of people, especially in rural Minnesota, but also a large percentage of urban citizens get their water from groundwater too. Some places do get surface, like St. Cloud and Minneapolis, get a lot of their water from the Mississippi River, actually. So some places do use surface water as their drinking water source.
Yeah, there were actually, according to the stats of the Department of Health, 3,120 drinking water wells in the Pine River watershed.
There you go. And then again, just to drill this home, groundwater is connected to our lakes and streams, and many of them are fed by groundwater to some degree. So if there is contaminants or pollution in the groundwater, that may end up in your favorite lake or stream. So this is just a basic diagram of sort of how groundwater works. There are areas higher up in topography that are called recharge areas, and so when rainfall lands on that area, a lot of that water will infiltrate into the ground. And then important thing to remember is that groundwater moves, and it moves from high water levels to lower water levels, and the water table will generally reflect the surface topography. So if you're standing at the bottom of the hill, the water table up at the top of the hill is going to be probably over your head. It sort of reflects the surface topography, and because of that, this water exerts pressure really on this lower water because of its weight, and so you'll get groundwater movement. and that's how groundwater gets into our streams and rivers. And then in many places, there are multiple aquifers stacked on top of each other. This would be called your surficial water, surficial aquifer. There's nothing containing it. It's not under pressure like these other aquifers are. So this is like if you just had an aquifer in a sand, sandy geology, that would be an unconfined aquifer. I think Sarah mentioned that what gets on with the water that comes through the land might end up in your stream or lake or well pretty fast. So there's pretty quick movement in an unconfined aquifer. That's usually like a sand material. There's a lot of porosity. Water can zoom right through that. So it might get to the stream, in a matter of days. Other places have a geology where this might be a real thick layer of bedrock that doesn't have any cracks and things in it. So, or it may have some, but water will get down into that area, but it takes a long time to get there, and it takes a long time to move into a lake or a stream. And then there can be even further aquifers downstream that take even longer to get water into them and get water to be released from them. These types of aquifers are under pressure. They're usually on a bigger geographical scale. So there will be places where there is higher topography feeding these confined aquifers, exerting pressure on that. And when you have these confining layers, that puts a cap on it, so the pressure can't be released. So if you punch a well into one of these confined aquifers, sometimes you'll get like an artesian well. It'll just flow automatically. And that's why that's happening, because there's pressure at higher elevations in that aquifer that are exerting that to force it out of your well. Otherwise, a lot of wells, I have a well at home, and I have a well pump in it. That's because it's a surficial aquifer. It doesn't have any of that pressure in it, so I have to pull the water up with a pump. But anyhow, it's important to realize that you've got these recharge areas and discharge areas. A lot of the discharge areas are like, say, streams and lakes and wetlands. Whoopsie, I did the wrong slide too. I go to, so I want to use these bottom ones to move. There we go. Oh, golly, I did it again. I want to use the top ones.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, here we go.
Sarah, this is a male thing.
Yeah. Huh. Somehow I think I've lost the picture to this one.
Yeah, let's back it up.
It was a similar picture to that.
Oh, well. But
somehow, sometimes PowerPoint does things like this. Anyhow, it sort of was a diagram just kind of depicting the artesian on wells and into the deeper aquifers and whatnot, and versus your shallow unconfined wells where you have to pump the water out. So we'll just bypass that one. Our understanding of groundwater has increased over time. It wasn't all that long ago, you know, in the 40s and 50s, we didn't really have much understanding of groundwater at all, and people used to pour stuff down their wells, and you know, it was just like, this is just going to go away somewhere, and we didn't realize that we were going to be drinking that water shortly. So anyhow, we know quite a bit about groundwater now, but there's still quite a bit that we don't know, as Sarah mentioned. There's a lot more emphasis now being placed on understanding and protecting our groundwater. Several different state agencies are putting forth big efforts in learning more about groundwater and as well as the protection issue. But it's not easy. Groundwater can be difficult to study and understand because we can't see it, unlike a lake or a river where you can see what's going on. So it's kind of tricky. I mentioned there's various agencies in the state of Minnesota that deal with groundwater, and they each sort of have their jurisdictions or their specialties. The Minnesota Department of Agriculture deals with nitrates, especially agriculturally sourced nitrates in groundwater and pesticides in groundwater. The Minnesota Department of Health deals with nitrates and arsenic, nitrates especially as far as the drinking water aspect of them. Other contaminants are dealt with by our agency, the Pollution Control Agency. You know, if there's toxic chemicals or petroleum leakage down into the groundwater, that type of thing.
Bisphenols, things like that.
Yeah, that's, we have a group in our Brainerd lab that deals with like petroleum remediation where gasoline tanks have leaked into the groundwater and stuff, so we have colleagues that deal with that. The DNR has jurisdiction over water, groundwater quantity, so they do all the permitting for like well pumping.
Irrigation for
yep, irrigation like pumping, well pumping. So they deal with quantity aspects. And then drinking water source protection, again, that's I believe that's a Minnesota Department of Health, where they'll actually, they actually can understand how the groundwater moves to a like a public municipal well, and they'll do special protections on the landscape over that source area where the groundwater is moving from to ensure that it doesn't become contaminated. So lots of different jurisdictions there. This is something that is ongoing right now, a joint effort between the DNR and the Minnesota Geological Society, or survey it might be, I'm not sure, it's MGS. But it's this County Geologic Atlas program, and I think there's a few counties where they've actually finished it, but not very many, like just a handful, like four or five or something like that. The Crow Wing is part of it's done, I believe, and part of it's still going on. There's two parts of these. There's like a geological part where they really describe like the bedrock, how deep the bedrock is, how thick the sand is on top, you know, kind of the structural stuff. And then there's a second part called Part B that deals with the hydrology, and that's the part that DNR develops. So that's more how the water is moving through the system, how quickly it gets down into those deeper aquifers, all that kind of stuff is also contained in these. And these are available online, so you can just Google. And I think I put a bunch of links on a piece of paper back there that you can take with you. Like I say, there's lots and lots to know about this, and the Department of Health has things on their website, Department of Ag, we do, we have a bunch of stuff. So you could spend a lot of time surfing the web for Minnesota groundwater information. But this is just an example I clipped from the Crow Wing map. You can see Whitefish Lake there. And this was, I believe this was surficial geology, and they were mapping sand and gravel source areas. And I think like the yellow was you know, a thick layer of sand on the surface, and that pink might have been like where there was some really sweet gravel sources or something for aggregate and whatnot. So, but anyhow, you can see it's real detailed, so you could figure out where you are in there and kind of see what your superficial geology is like. And then they have parts of here that deal with the deeper geology as well. And again, you can get these on the internet. So I don't know what the timeline is. I think these take multiple years to produce a full one. But like I say, the Crow Wing one's part done, and they're working on various counties across the state. This is kind of a progress map of where things are at. So I believe they kind of started in the Twin Cities counties and then are kind of moving out from there, but they haven't done much in western Minnesota yet. So one of the things that's important to think about and why we were asked to speak is just the risks to groundwater, and Sarah covered this to some degree. It involves land use, you know, what we do on the landscape has a big effect. And it also involves what the geology is like at that given location. So land use things would be agricultural chemicals and fertilizers, storage tanks, like I mentioned, petroleum storage tanks under gas stations and whatnot, non-conforming septic systems, failing septic systems, chemical spills, landfills, abandoned wells sometimes, and probably more so in the past when people didn't understand groundwater as well, but I'm sure this still happens to some degree. Some people find, you know, have an abandoned well on their property or something and want to get rid of some pesticides they got left over or something, and it's like, well, here, we'll just pour it down this hole and it'll go away. anyhow, that's why I think it's run by the Minnesota Department of Health. They have an abandoned well program, and you're supposed to, I think it's filling them with concrete to abandon them so that.
Just read that. The issue on abandoned wells, take that one very seriously. Because
yeah.
On old properties, if you had a well, for whatever reason, wasn't functioning, years ago, what would happen is you'd hire somebody, they'd come in and drill a new well, and they'd leave the other one.
Yeah.
Well, part of the problem is it's now exposed that groundwater.
Yep.
To whatever.
It's a direct line. It doesn't go through soil or anything.
Groundwater, you drilled a new well 10 feet away, guess what? Got the bad source going right into the good source, and you can't
right.
Get salt
dang quick. Yep. And when you sell properties and whatnot, now you're.
They do the concrete fill them and then they cap them and they register
yep.
them. And so.
They record that it's been taken care of and whatnot. And anytime you sell property, if you've sold property, you've probably seen that there's a spot on there where you're supposed to disclose if there's any abandoned wells on your property and whatnot for that reason as well. But anything to.
Not yet, no.
Okay. And then things about the geology that can make certain areas riskier than others is just the soil types, the bedrock types, and the permeability, which has, you know, relates to the soil types. Certainly sandy soils like we have around here, things are going to move a lot faster
yeah.
and percolate down in the groundwater than you, if you have like a heavy clay soil or something. So,
and another risk factor, and this is something the Department of Health, I believe, has data on. It's not publicly available data because they're afraid of the wrong people getting a hold of it and making use of it. But they have this, one of the parameters they use when they're determining risk is called time of travel. And what they're doing is they're determining, you know, if you get a contaminant in location A, how long, how far is that contaminant going to move over the course of the next year? And some areas, and I believe the pine is one, you have a pretty high rate of time of travel. In other words, if you get a contamination in one area, there's a good likelihood it moves a good distance over the course of over the next few months before. And why it's important is if you're trying to nail down the source or trying to somehow contain a source of contamination, you know, you got to act quickly. And otherwise, it can move quickly and cover a lot of area.
Another area, just out of curiosity for you, the southeastern part of Minnesota has what's called karst geology, which is limestone. That's an area that didn't get the glaciation this last time around. And so it didn't scar off the surface and everything. So it's really, really old bedrock. And it's very close to the surface, just a few feet under the surface. Under all those cornfields you see down there, there's like 3 feet of soil, and then it's limestone bedrock. And it's very cracked. That kind of geology dissolves over time, so there's all kinds of cracks and fissures in there. So things from those farm fields can get down into their groundwater really fast. And that part of the state has a lot of problem with nitrate in their groundwater. There's oodles of wells in places where there's, you know, where it's over the 10 milligram or microgram per liter, milligram per liter standard. So there's people have looked at groundwater vulnerability and mapped that. And again, the four factors there are kind of the aquifer materials, the recharge potential, how much precipitation you get and stuff, and how that's going to be percolating through is going to affect that vulnerability. And this was a map that our agency did back in the late 80s. And I guess the takeaway here is the red is the most susceptible area to contamination from activities on the ground or things seeping in from the ground surface. And you can see the Whitefish Chain areas there is pretty much in a red spot. So
I'm guessing that Richard Smith probably had the same map on his presentation last time.
No, but I'm going to send it to him.
Well, he's been using this ever since. Yeah. This is one that I put in my original analysis of the pipeline, and Richard grabbed it, and so it's he's had it for a long time.
And I guess one thing I could just mention quick is the area right up here. Like Park Rapids is up in here, and there's a lot of potato farming as well as they do corn and soybeans and stuff up there too. But it's all grown on pure sand and it's irrigated, and needless to say, they have a lot of problems with nitrate in their groundwater up there. And Park Rapids, the city had to put in a new municipal well 2-3 years ago, and they had to go pretty deep with it to get down into those deeper aquifers. Because of that, they had problems with iron and manganese, so they had to build a treatment plant to get those materials out, which they didn't used to have to worry about with their shallower well. And that cost about $5 million or something for the city to do. So as Sarah said, it's important to protect the groundwater because it's expensive if you have to either fix it or treat it in order to drink it first.
So. One of the concerns of the PCA in recent years has been that conversion of the forest area to ag, you know, where they apply the fertilizers and the chemicals and the pesticides. And really, if you want to trash your groundwater, the first thing you want to do pretty much is start leveling your forest, because where you've got forest cover, you've got pretty good groundwater and it's really well protected. But as soon as you start taking that forest cover down, you put your groundwater at risk, and then you add in, you know, nitrates and chlorothalonil and other contaminants, and you know, it becomes a whole different thing. But but the first step to ruining your groundwater is to knock down your forest.
So what is the main reason in our area there?
These red areas are primarily really sandy soils, and that's basically what they use to produce this map. Like this is down here, this is the Anoka sand plain. And then like I mentioned, Park Rapids area is really, really sandy. The Brainerd area is really sandy. So that's predominantly this area along up here. This is what they call the Beach Ridge, and it was the beach of Glacial Lake Agassiz. So it's an area where there's a lot of sand and gravel,
and
where there was some nice beaches
and really shallow groundwater.
Yeah.
The combination of the coarse sands and the shallow groundwater.
And then this is that karst area they talked about. That's all limestone down here.
Okay, I'll.
Yeah, Scott can.
So this was actually a layer that the DNR just developed about. They finished about 2 weeks ago. They've been working on it for quite a while, but it combines a number of data sets, and they use it to determine the depth to groundwater, you know, in a given area. And this is the Pine River watershed. And as you can see, is that the red there? That's 0 to 10 feet in depth. So far and away, most of the Pine River watershed has extremely shallow groundwater relative to, you know, what you're going to see elsewhere in the state. That's 0 to 10 feet. That's not where your wells necessarily obviously are, but you start seeing the hydric soils in the groundwater at that depth, or
that,
less,
that would be
and
the
a lot of it's
surface
less
of
than
the
that.
Water table.
That's 0 to 10, so it could be surface water, it could be go all the way down to, you know.
On the Whitefish Chain, just for orientation purposes.
So we're sitting right here, I guess, right now. Yep.
Yes.
I have a question. Just before we get on our dock, it's always kind of spongy there, and I think there's water bubbling up.
Sure.
It's only about 2 feet
Could
away
be.
From the lake shore.
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean that that's where my water table is?
Well, you're.
Repeat the question.
Okay, yeah, just before you get to the lake shore, the ground starts getting spongy, and the question is that where the water table is? Well, that's where the seasonally high water table is, but your water table could actually go up from there. You know, you can have the water table typically oftentimes follow the surface of the ground, and so it's going to flow. I don't know who's doing that.
I don't know. I'm not trying.
I think
to.
It's you. But I mean, you can have your water table can be very, where you're 20 feet above the lake, it can be very high, and then it can go down there. But what you're seeing there is actually wetland. I mean, you're looking at saturated soils that are right up against the top, and certainly your water table is there, but I mean it can go very close to the surface higher up too.
Yep. And you can have like little seeps of groundwater, you know, right near the lake or near a stream. We see that a lot in streams.
Yeah.
And you can have some, you know, softer, the water is actually kind of under pressure and coming up. So it's kind of almost like suspending. That's what causes like quicksand, is where you have a really strong, you know, upwelling of groundwater, and it sort of is just suspending that sand. And so. Yeah.
Historically, I mean, back in the day, people didn't think anything of filling a wetland. You know, you had a wet spot, you put some dirt in there and filled it. Well, then, you know, 30 or 40 years later, nature reclaimed its own. You start seeing that water reappear there again, those areas. And so it's just sometimes it's what you're looking at is areas where it's been filled in the past, but now the water's starting to, you know, it's the wetland's starting to reclaim itself. And I mean, the reason varies, but yeah, that's where your water is. Yeah.
Yep.
Well, sometimes that can be just decaying organic material, you know, that's causing that. You know, you have stuff running down there and then eventually bubbles out of there. I mean, in fact, a lot of the areas around here, this was not necessarily near a lake, but this was an area that was logged heavily back in the 1800s. And they had, and a lot of the rivers around here in this watershed were used to move those logs downstream, you know. So they had all these dams constructed, all this kind of stuff. Well, that infrastructure was never really taken out. It just kind of fell in there and rotted. And so, I mean, we've got a lot of history here where it's just sitting under the surface of the water, where it's just decaying and rotting and causing, you know, unknown issues with dissolved oxygen and that type of thing. But, you know, most likely it's just rotting organic material, but of course a lot of the log dams and stuff were constructed from organic material, so that's, you know.
And you've got your lily pad roots that, you know,
yeah,
the lily pads
that kind
die
of thing
after a while, and you know, the roots decay. And
or dying critters or, you know, all kinds of stuff, so
yeah.
That's right. Most likely what's happening
right
there.
Right now this year, of course, you've got about 4 or 5 inches of additional water that still hasn't drained out of here.
So, you know, take away on that is that a lot of this watershed has got high water table.
Take away
so
from this is that what you do on the land is going to most likely affect your groundwater really easily.
Really
I mean,
bad.
That's the reason that this caught my eye, because I was looking at best management practices to try to address surface water runoff, like infiltration basins and buffers and storage, you know, filtration basins and retention basins and that type of thing. And I'm trying to avoid using practices in areas where you've got potentially contaminated runoff and you've got a shallow groundwater table, because then you're looking at, okay, we're fixing the surface water problem, but we're adding to the groundwater problem. And so I want to make sure that when we do this, you know, we're cognizant of the fact that, you know, we have shallow groundwater. Let's put a practice in place here that's not necessarily going to impact the groundwater, or will protect the groundwater and the surface water. And for residences along the Whitefish Chain, you know, an infiltration basin is probably a pretty good thing. But you start putting it where you've got a lot of concrete runoff and a lot of other contaminants or agriculture runoff, that type of thing, then it becomes a little bit more risky, and so you have to be more careful.
Oh, and MD, I said I wouldn't talk about pipelines, but I couldn't resist this map. Would you draw the proposed Sandpiper line?
Oh, gosh, where are we at? It just goes, I can't draw it off of my memory, Tom, but
I'm
going to
suggest to you it's coming in from Bot Bass.
Right, yep, and it goes right by Jail Lake there, and
so
yeah.
So here's,
and then, well, that's
Lawrence and Roosevelt.
Yeah, it goes by Washburn up there, though. It's closer to Washburn.
Here.
Yep. Now a little above that. There you go.
Yeah,
right there. Yeah.
Jogs
right through there. Yep.
This is our watershed, and the point I'm making here is, last month when we did the pipeline piece to connect to the Kalamazoo spill issue, this is all shallow, and there they were dealing with deeper water, and that took 6 years before it essentially settled to the bottom of that area. And you can see how much margin we have in this area before we start to get into those waters.
And there's a lot of wetland in that area too, along there between, you know, that stretch.
Sorry for interrupting.
No, go ahead.
No, that's fine.
It's fine, Tom.
Yeah.
I knew you weren't going to help yourself.
Yeah.
We've been coming up here for over 30 years, and one of the things that I noticed in the last number of years, when I take Highway 1 to Pine River, I see some very, very large feedlots.
Yep.
On the right-hand side. Your agency monitor that? Because now I look at that and I'm going, wow, that's a
problem. Right.
It's feedlots are kind of a combination between the county and the state, and
that's about the only thing related to agriculture that the Minnesota Pollution Control has regulation over, and it depends on the size of the feedlot.
It's like 999 units or something.
Yeah, that there's actually federal permits that you have to get if you're over 1,000 animal units. And is one animal unit a cow, basically?
Yeah.
Because like chickens are like a tenth of an animal unit.
But his point is correct. And I can tell you that in Minnesota, there are two places along here. You spoke on one, there's another one on 15. I think there's six people that do regulatory work on feedlots in Minnesota.
Yeah, they're very understaffed. Rhonda Atkins is covering like half the state.
Have we measured it? We're currently got some work underway right now in what's called the Willow Creek area, which would be that wetland as you turn off one, going south on 15, about a quarter of a mile, you go through a little bit of a wetland on the left-hand side, you get a feedlot on the right. We're currently doing some work in that area as part of this WRAP project.
Yeah, that's to protect that creek.
The upstream piece west of Pine River, we've been doing some work back there forever. There's people here that have been at this a lot longer. Up in the in Bongo Creek in that area west, which is a lot of farmland.
So basically all they have to do is split up their feedlots into 900 and 900, and they got it made.
No, I'll give you the answer that I would give you is this, and I'm proud to say I'm going to a dinner with the Cass County Farm Bureau on Saturday night. If you want a good dinner for $25, I'll get you a ticket. But we've had great success. Scott knows this. We've had great success working with the Cass County Farm Bureau on the farmers taking responsibility for drainage on their own properties. Because all of a sudden it dawned on them, their economics and their economy and their well-being is tied to what happens in this whole area. And their voluntary activity is a hell of a lot better than anything the government could require them to do.
We've got some really good people in this watershed as far as taking care of things and doing their part. But on the other hand, what you said there about that happens too. You know, there's some of that where things get moved around a lot and.
So basically those really big feedlots, those in some ways, those are the least polluting. It might seem sort of counterintuitive, but the reason is because in order to get their permit, they have to show, based on the topography and how they have their cows and everything, that they have zero discharge of any nutrients and whatnot. So those are actually fairly regulated. The ones that potentially can cause problems are if people have 200 cows or whatever, and there's really not that regulatory oversight over them, so they can kind of just do what they want. So in some ways, the bigger ones are, there's just more eyes on them and more oversight into what they're doing. The only other problem with those big ones is they have to do something with the manure, and so it's usually spread on farm fields, which is a good thing for soil and whatnot, but you can get nitrate problems and whatnot from manure if you put too much manure on, and a lot of these places generate a lot of manure, and it can be sometimes hard to find a place to put it. So they have to have like manure plans, and there's regulations on when they can apply. You can't apply it when the snow is melting, so you got frozen ground, so it can't seep in and stuff. There's regulations on that, but there's still impacts out there. And the other kind of concerning thing for us is that like in the neighboring Crow Wing watershed just to the west of here, there are larger feedlots moving in for I know that there was a large swine one that just moved in, and they're kind of moving up from southern Minnesota because they're trying to find more isolated areas so that they don't have so many animal disease problems and whatnot. So they're kind of quarantining themselves by coming into these more isolated areas. And also we have so much available groundwater here, which they don't have in some of the other parts of the state. So we're seeing migration into this area of more feedlot type activity. So that is a concern for groundwater and surface water and pollution issues. So something to be concerned about. I'll let Scott talk about this too. The green dots on here are all the wells in this watershed.
Yeah.
and...
Just what I thought was interesting about this, so those are the wells, but this is what I, what struck me when I did the layer for the wraps, is that here's your, this is your highest susceptibility to contamination right here, this tan, which is almost pretty much in alignment with where most of those wells are, which I was, which struck me that, that that's where, you know, where you have your highest vulnerability to contamination is where people are digging their wells. That, that was the main thing that surprised me about that slide. And I mean, it's not to say that the wells themselves are vulnerable because they're deeper, you know, but it, but just that I thought was interesting, that that vulnerability concept where we're digging our wells. So, I mean, and again, if you're looking at time of travel and that type of thing, you would think by looking at this map that that if you have a contamination, some kind of a spill or some kind of a incident in this area, there's a good likelihood it flows through and contaminates a lot of wells.
I got this from the Minnesota Department of Agriculture website. This was a list of things, well contamination risks, and it's just wells that are more at risk are ones that are dug. I guess that means, you know, back in the day, hand dug even. Drive point, I guess, I think that means sand point, I'm guessing. And bored wells, that confused me a little bit because I thought most typical drilled wells are bored, unless that means something else that I don't know. But anyhow, I think what they're kind of saying is it's the more do-it-yourself sort of homemade wells are probably going to be more at risk. Old wells that are improperly maintained, wells older than 1974, that's the time when well construction rules were adopted by the legislature, so there was a lot more oversight into how wells were constructed after that point on. Shallow wells that are less than or near 50 feet deep, especially, you know, in these sandy areas, we talked about how quick things can get there. Damaged wells, wells that have been flooded, there was a question kind of about that. I think they were talking about wells where the actual well, you know, pipe coming out of the ground, if that's underwater, you know, water can surface water can actually seep then down into the well, and you can have contamination from surface runoff getting down into there directly into the well. Wells located near a chemical spill, you know, like your gas tank leakage, you know, a lot of times adjacent properties will have contaminated wells and have to figure out something else to do about their water.
What do you mean by a improperly maintained well?
I'm not as sure. This is where we're sort of out of our element a little bit, but if you look at that sheet that I had, there's like a well owner's guidebook that's put out by the Minnesota Department of Health, and that's available on their website. So any kind of questions on maintenance of wells or upkeep, that type of thing, I would look at that website, and I'm guessing it's pretty good. And then wells that don't meet isolation setbacks, there's certain rules, and this is probably tied in with that 1974 date. This is probably one of the things they looked at was you have to have your well a certain distance from like your septic drain field and whatnot.
Most of it's about 75 feet.
Yeah, so there's 90, regulations. 90. So the, you know, the closer, if you have a well that's closer than that, maybe an old well or something, it's more likely going to be able to be contaminated. I kind of mentioned that state agencies are putting more and more emphasis on groundwater management, and there's actually a new program by DNR where they're looking at some really specific management of groundwater in a few pilot areas. One is the Straight River area around Park Rapids. One is an area called Bonanza Valley, which kind of runs from Glenwood to Haynesville, sort of south of Alexandria. White Bear Lake, you might have heard of White Bear Lake level declines substantially over the last like 10 years. That's where a lot of St. Paul gets their drinking waters from, some of those deeper aquifers that feed White Bear Lake, and so it's the water level's gone way down there. And then Little Rock Creek is another one that's down by Rice on Highway 10. That's not an official groundwater management zone, but they're doing more there than they've done before. So they're doing a lot of studies trying to really define how the groundwater moves, how the aquifer dynamics, how much you can pump to keep it sustainable and those types of things. So this will probably move to other areas as they learn how to approach this in these pilot areas. But
we've seen some of the things they've done in Wisconsin with excessive irrigation. I mean, they've drained entire lakes, and so we're trying to prevent the same type. And we're seeing similar things, at least symptoms that like Little Rock Creek, for example, like Kevin talks about. There's strange things there where the upstream, or is it the downstream, is lower. Less water in the downstream than there is in the upstream, something like that. Yeah. So it's like losing
water. Little Rock Creek is a trout stream, actually. So it's a cold water stream, which cold water streams are more dominated by groundwater flow. That's why they're cold. And there's been a lot of, it's a really sandy area, just like here. And there's been a lot of increase in irrigated agriculture there. And there's really high nitrates in the groundwater now in that area. And then the creek itself is above the drinking water standard of 10. So, and that triggered us to do a TMDL there because that's within the diameter geographic area of St. Cloud's drinking water. It's kind of their drinking water source area. So therefore that creek is held to the drinking water standard. Like I said, Park Rapids has a lot of nitrate problems with their groundwater because of the farming there. Bonanza Valley, they do a lot of irrigation in that area too. So White Bear Lake, it's more of a water level issue with the aquifer. This was a report that I just scanned through really quickly yesterday, but it's a really good report. It tells you a lot about the whole arsenic issue in the groundwater, where it is and isn't, and how substantial it is in various places. It talks a lot about nitrate. It talks about the pollution, like petroleum pollution areas, and a lot of things like that. So, if you're interested, it's on our website, and it's a good bedtime read. I'll maybe let Scott talk a little bit about this. This is new also. You've heard us talk about the WRAPs, that's the Watershed Restoration and Protection Strategies. This is a new thing related to that, and I'll let Scott.
So when I started working on the Pine River WRAPs, as I said before, I really wanted to have a groundwater element in the WRAPs and make sure that we were working together because the Department of Health isn't particularly well funded. And it's hard for them to get money to do projects to protect groundwater. So I thought, well, okay, if we can use money for implementation for surface water and also benefit groundwater, everybody's better for it. So Carrie Raber and some of the staff there went ahead and they had these plans like the WRAPs called the GRAPs, but they've only done a couple of them so far. Well, I made sure that one of them was in the Pine River watershed. And so we had this plan developed to protect groundwater restoration and protection strategy. In the Pine as well. And they had there's a lot of really great information here. The DNR contributed and the Department of Health contributed, and I think we contributed a little bit. But
so is that finished now?
I believe it's finished now. This is the draft version I just printed off, but I think they have a finalized version of that now.
So that's available on our website.
Well, I don't know if it's on our website yet, but okay. I should probably put it there, yeah. It'll be attached to the WRAPs anyway when it's done. When that's done, this is going to be one of the appendices. But there's a couple of things, it said roughly a third of the wells in the wells now, and again, I want to differentiate between vulnerable water, surface water, vulnerable groundwater, because you're talking about 10 feet deep and less there, but the wells actually, one third in the Pine River watershed are located in highly vulnerable settings. So roughly one third of the 3,000 some wells in the Pine River watershed, around 1,000 of them are in highly vulnerable situations. And then, and I talked about this before, the Pine River watershed is actually rated, the U.S. Forest Service did a study a few years ago on producing clean water, and both groundwater and surface water, And the Pine River watershed was actually rated as the number three watershed in the entire upper northeast United States. I mean, going all the way to Maine and Maryland out there, and then across and down to Missouri and over. Pine River watershed was the number three watershed in that entire area for producing clean water, largely because of our very, you know, our excellent forest cover that we have here, and a number of other, you know, reasons as well. But when you start taking that forest cover away, that's, I guess, say you've started to destroy your groundwater and your surface water. I mean, because that is the simplest, you know, what nature does to protect water, both in maintaining the water cycle and infiltrating and protecting against erosion and all the and nutrient usage. All those things happen with forest cover. Okay, and then once they take it away, they stop. Okay, then you've got to do artificial infiltration, artificial nutrients, you know, somehow soak up those nutrients, or, I mean, all those things now become a mat, you know, we try to take over and control all that stuff that nature's done for 10,000 years now. Anyway, that was there's a lot more to the graphs than that, but those are just two bullets I took out of there that I thought were worth knowing about or worth understanding.
Yeah, so if nothing else, we don't know if it's on our website yet because it's brand new, but Scott can get you.
I'm pretty sure Gordy and Steve and some of the others probably already have a copy or at least have seen it in our RAPS work. So, yeah, Jim.
How do you define forest cover?
That's a good question. I'm thinking. Okay, so they're looking at just where you have heavy dense forest. But whether that includes like plantations or like logging areas where they replant, I'm gonna go ahead and say I would say it probably to a percentage because as you remove, when they take these aerial photographs and they do these land use maps, you know, some of the forest is clear because they're doing logging there, but others is being restored. And then as time goes on, they'll turn around and log those and the other one will be growing. So I think that probably balances out. So I think that basically where you've got trees, and it averages out. But there's a lot of areas, of course, that we just have pretty much undisturbed forest. I mean, there's not a whole lot that's gone on in the last foreseeable, I mean, to our memory. I mean, you go back to, again, the 1800s, almost everything was logged up at that one time. But I would say right now, that's what you're looking at, unbroken forest land, or at least connected forest land.
Yeah, and I'm aware of some research that looked at there's a whole field of study called forest hydrology, and one of our Minnesota hydrologists did a study that showed that it took about, I think, 13 to 15 years for a clear-cut forest that's just left alone. It takes about 15 years of regeneration until it's like back to its normal hydrology there. So you'll get more surface runoff and whatnot after you've like clear cut a forest, and then if it regenerates, it'll gradually naturalize again and come back to.
And actually, Don Rosenberry with the USGS service has suggested too that logging, clear cut logging, can also affect groundwater, and also it can create a situation where you have phosphorus transport underneath the surface of the ground to a surface water, like Kegel Lake, for example. We talked about that as a possibility over there with the logging and stuff they have up in that, you know, area there. What, anyway, go ahead.
We're probably getting short on time.
Yeah, we are. We're way over now. We blew that out.
I think I only, okay, that's the last slide there. This is what I have in the back. So it's got, like I say, we have lots of information on our website. There's a drinking water source protection section on the Minnesota Department of Health. There's a GRAPS website. There's the Minnesota Department of Ag has a whole deal about their nitrate and pesticide monitoring. Department of Health has information about protecting your well, and then, like I mentioned, that Minnesota Well Owners Handbook. So this sheet is back there on the table. I just thought I'd show you this cool really quick. It was kind of my question slide, but this was a site that we visit on a field tour, but this is actually a stream just coming right out of a cliff, and it's down in southeastern Minnesota. This is pretty common, actually. I mentioned in that karst, you can see limestone.
Looks like Winona County.
You can see the limestone, you know, bedrock here, and it's all fractured, and you get these streams that just come gushing right out of a cliff. It's really neat, and this water is really cold and really, you know, crystal clear, gin clear water, but there's probably nitrates over the drinking water limit in there.
I'm going to suck up one more 30 seconds more, Jim, on your question. One more thing I wanted to point out is that based on the stuff I learned in college, forest isn't necessarily forest. Certain trees take up more nutrients and utilize more nutrients than other trees do. For example, mixed hardwoods use up the most nutrients. They take up the most nutrients, they hold the most nutrients, they use them up. If you take a mixed hardwood forest, knock it down, then plant conifers or like aspen, you're not getting the same nutrient balance. In other words, you're still going to be spilling some nutrients into the, even if you replace those other trees. So trees aren't trees necessarily with regard to water quality. Okay, I'm done.
And I think probably those are taken at various times too. In other words, where they've logged them off, because those are aerial photographs.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, it's like the point is that it's the natural. Some of this county or some of this area is conifer, and some of this area is mixed hardwood. But it doesn't really benefit you to knock one forest down and replace it with a different type. It's better than nothing, but it's not the equal to what was originally there.
I know we've asked a lot of questions for those of you that stuck here. All of this was to give you 3 credits toward understanding drinking water. I actually am teaching a college class this semester, so if you give me your names, you'll get 3 credits in corporate finance. But does this raise questions that when you have these folks together now that you've seen kind of the two sides of this whole subject, I think what's common to all of this is one of them said early on, you open the tap, you take out some water, you drink on it, you bathe in it, you prepare your food in it. We've always assumed that, well, since we can't see it, it must be pretty good, right? We're still here, soil's below our feet in the morning, it's a good thing. What questions have you got for these guys? Any others? My objective is to not have you here beyond 4 o'clock, so you can only ask one or two. Others? Yes.
We put recently a whole house water filter, and it's one you replace every month or every 2 months.
Yep.
And took it out and went, look, it's rust colored.
Yeah.
Scary thought.
Yeah. So is it taking out anything else, or?
How about the water filter?
Should be.
It depends on the type of system it is and what it was designed to do. Is it a reverse osmosis?
No,
it's just like an iron system. Filter.
Just an iron filter.
So what it's doing is it's cleaning up and binding up all that iron in your water, which iron is, not a health concern, but it's an aesthetic issue that we have. It stains
and a taste issue,
it stains your clothes.
It comes up your coffee maker.
Your faucet.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's bad for your plumbing, and it'll build up. That's probably what it's doing, is just taking out that iron. Those filters are designed to take out specific things. So if it's taking out iron, that doesn't mean it's taking out other things.
It could be, but
not necessarily. It's probably not taking out arsenic. Arsenic's a very small, specialized
molecule.
You can
get a filter that takes out other stuff.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You can get a whole series of filters that'll take out anything you want.
Okay.
Yeah. All
right.
Yes.
Will there be other sessions dealing with these issues, particularly the pipeline in coming months?
Good, thank you. Did I give you that question? We actually have one we just did in July on the Kalamazoo piece. That line, video is actually on our website. We're going to start videoing these because one of the feedback we've had is there are a number of people who want to participate in these matters. The problem is we're doing them on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursdays typically, and they're not here until Friday or Saturday. Second, we are going to continue to monitor impacts on water quality and surface water and groundwater in this area, big time. Part of what I think becomes an interest here is, and I don't have a specific date to do those, but I will just say to you that the next one I think we're going to take a look at, partially because my pal over here introduced it, actually, and that is really the whole subject of conservation easements and easements that are being placed and encouraged. Mm-hmm. Heather Baird from the DNR has been a big advocate of looking at the minor watersheds around here and looking upstream from the lake shores and starting to look at forest protection and how you manage those. And by putting easements on those doesn't mean you're prohibited from ever using them. It just indicates that you're going to subscribe to some ways that you're going to manage those better than others. But more likely, we're going to keep forested land away from the lake, which does a couple of things. It disperses all that water flow means we're gonna have probably some less erosion and some of those kinds of matters. The worst thing we got in this chain of lakes right now is we got stormwater runoff, and it's carrying with it everything known to man and beyond. And so part of that's really a good thing, you know, upstream, and I think that's what you were touching on earlier. Mm-hmm. So we're gonna do more of that, and that's probably gonna be the fall piece. We've got one of our board members that's starting to work on that. He's actually doing one himself in the trout minor watershed. The pipeline piece, here's what I can tell you at the moment. The big dog in our area hasn't quite figured out exactly what they're gonna do totally. We do know that Sandpiper is probably, let's just say the train has halted on that. We don't know where it's going, and we don't know whether they've suspended it, whatever. They have committed another $1 billion to buy into what's called Dakota Access, which heads through the Dakotas across Iowa and back to Chicago. The piece that's common to all of this that's pretty interesting, and I'm a newbie in starting to understand this stuff, but I'm scared by what I've seen. And you remember the little red map showing the depth of water that we commented on. That alone should tell you, Kalamazoo, it took human beings 17 hours to shut off valves to prevent that spill of 1.1 billion, about million gallons of oil, of crude, heavy crude. It took human beings. Now, the Enbridge will tell you that they've got tools in place to prevent those kinds of things from happening. These are human beings. And you can imagine with that red map, how long it gets into what is ultimately
I believe it was carried like 70 miles or something downstream.
Yellowstone as well was carried that
far. So there's been a lot of those incidents. We're going to try to continue to monitor line three. Watch line three. Forget Sandpiper for the moment. Line three exists on Highway 2. It's been there for 50, 60 years. Nobody knows its condition. Enbridge does not want to expose it. They don't want to have to dig it up because for fear of what they're going to find, which means remediation maybe at their nickel also. But they don't want to do it. The second reason they don't want to do it, there's an argument at the moment. There may be a need to reverse at some time in the future transporting water from the Great Lakes back to the Dakotas. And there may be some existing lines that might very well be abandoned at some time in the future with our successors who may very well permit.
I didn't know that was a theory that was being. I mean that was one of those under the table things people talked about early on
it's
in the process.
The surface.
Okay.
The new line three that's on this corridor that we just talked about going through the northern part of our watershed is actually a bigger pipe. It's about
twice the size of Sandpiper.
Transporting much more oil under more pressure than before, and it's this heavy crude. Which is tar sands, tar. Watch the way they put tar on a road, asphalt, that's the same material. The difference is they liquefy it with benzene and other basically flammable products, and that's where the fires come from. Now there's a theory going on right now, while I've got you, I'll just tell you this, watch this story going on, which is, may it be smarter to transport tar sands in its natural form, unfortunately in cars, railroad cars, trucks, than it is to liquefy it with a flammable material and then liquefy it when it gets to its destination. So if you had a train car spill, this stuff isn't going to flow like water, which is the problem with Bakken. But that one's coming along, and many of us are still working on that sort of thing. If you're interested in some of this, there is a conversation on this subject Monday morning at 9 o'clock over an outing. And we'll do some more as time passes on that particular matter. The biggest threat we've got in this area, folks, I hate to say this, and I'm an old man, it's us. It's our neighbors, it's us. In other words, we're not being dutiful and responsible for what we were given. In this particular area, we're abusing and misusing this property. I will remember one thing Peter Jacobson told me. The problem with the Whitefish Chain, it's such a wonderful area, it's a popular area. The economics of this area is enormous compared to anywhere else in Minnesota away from the Twin Cities. But because it's so popular, it's overused. We have more boat traffic, we have bigger boats, we create more wake, we create more water temperature, we create more impacts negatively to the water habitat and that chemistry. In other words, the word they've used for friend of mine Ron Way used, we're loving our lake to death. So we have to change that habit. Have you ever tried to stand at a landing with a guy with a 30-foot wake boat, telling him that he probably shouldn't come here and should go somewhere else? Probably get killed first, but any last questions? Thank you very much.
Thanks,
Sarah, Scott, Kevin.
It's great to be here. Thanks for all that you guys are doing.